Somewhat.
Hey, Earl, what's this bit that was sent to us by Mikey Boy's guy? What's his name?
Sleeves.
Yeah. Do you want to play that or?
Oh boy, long. Very long.
Long what?
Gone with the Wind long. You know, the tight little bits.
Earl, what do you think?
Nah, it's too long.
But here's the thing. Mikey Boy's a big fan of the guy. Says he's a unique personality. Perry's a fan of his, too. Well, I haven't listened to it. Is it funny? Is it interesting?
It's interesting in spots, but it's just way...
In spots?
It's just way too long.
Because you're funny occasionally.
Just a hit and miss.
Yeah. There are times when you're very amusing.
And then, poof, it's gone again.
Yeah.
Really, it's a big epic.
I'm going to tell you right now, I've never gotten a bad... A bum move here for Mikey Boy, who I really trust is the actual producer of the show.
Well, he is great, but I'm just saying, it's kind of like a Wyatt Earp. It's a big epic, but no.
Mikey Boy would be with us on a full-time basis, except for he needs money to live, and our guys don't.
He's a fashionable lawyer.
Jay, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, how's it going?
Yeah.
I want to let you know, there was a guy a couple of years ago, I think it was on Ripley's Believe It or Not. He was blind just like that other dude using the echolocation.
Yeah.
He was teaching other people how to do it, and he was riding a bike and shit.
I choose not to believe it. If they say you can believe it or not, I'm always going to pick not.
That was Dean Cain's TV show, Ripley's Believe It or Not, when it was in syndication. I wonder if that thing's still on. They were supposed to do a movie of Ripley's Believe It or Not with Jim Carrey and Tim Burton directing, but the financing got pulled on that thing.
It is true. You are only funny occasionally.
Yes, in spots.
What do you feel the need to do? Here's a fun fact for you. It's Fez's fun fact.
It's just a factoid, really.
I want to hear this bit. And it's short?
All right. No, it's quite long. It's very, very long. And it goes on and on.
So do you. And you're in here every day.
Well, that's a good point.
Earl, let me hear your vote. Yes or no?
I would say no. It's too long.
I'm going to have to give it a thumbs down.
Fez, you haven't listened.
I have not heard it. Yeah. The only thing I've heard about it is it may be too long.
What's your vote?
I'll say no if it's too long.
0-3, I want to give it a shot. I really feel like taking the odds on.
Okay, but you know, you might live to regret it, is all I'm saying.
I won't. I'll be happy that I'm taking a piss. Here it is. Sleeves is his name? Sleeves?
Yeah, it goes by the name Sleeves, and it's called The
Young Brother Run by the Name of Sleeves.
And the piece is called The Natural.
Once upon a time, there was a chubby little boy cowering in the beach sand, his little big bottom mooning out of the little big boy trunks his mother had picked out for him. This was little Fez Marie Watley, and this was his first time to the beach. What a sad introduction to the life of Riley. His mouth was full of sand, his face was red with shame, and even his fatty tears were imprisoned in the gritty dust packing the corners of his eyes. For Fez was being treated to the old Charles Atlas by a merciless and smelly gang of very weak, very pale, very cold-fingered little boys, each wearing a large, crooked pair of glasses, and on their respective thumbs, a cheap souvenir ring from the snack shop gumball machine. But a gang, nonetheless. An organization as heartless as a pack of dogs. And young Fez Watley had no choice but to submit to their brutal fury. They were just about to begin a second round of sand kicking when a bit of a too strong, too black shadow verged into their midst. A shadow much darker, richer, and threatening than any shadow cast by any of them. They stood back, capped their foreheads with their palms.
Beat it.
A small, curving voice boomed, confident, compelling, both cat-like and cocksure. And the little gang scattered like mice. Fez shaded his eyes to discover the identity of his able savior.
Who are you?
He gasped as the gravel dust exploded from his lips, like the time his mean brother dared him to whistle with his mouth full of saltines. And oh, the trouble he'd gotten into with Mother. But he could only see the proud and brooding, the short, magnificent outline of his hero, who soon rotated out of the sun and lowered a hand to help the young baggy victim.
My name's Ron. You could call me Ron, said Ron, in a little leather bomber jacket, blue jeans, and black boots.
Fez was smitten by this too-good-to-be-true and too-bad-to-be-false fellow who stood in the 100-degree heat in full tough-guy regalia with nary a glisten of sweat, cool as the proverb-lacking cucumber. Although, curiously later, Ron would be sought out by sundry ladies just for this vegetable quality. Ron began to glide off. As he did, he muttered,
Dumbass.
Under his breath, his catch-all for nitwits and nincompoops.
Wait!
Cried Fez, bounding forward weakly over his trumpet thighs.
How did you do that, back there with those boys?
Fez asked, mouth still full of the strange hard cereal known as sand. Ron allowed his right eye to slowly take its vertus to gaze at young Fez.
A day under one condition, he squinted.
What?
Fez said.
Anything!
Gig sand in your own face, and I'll tell you how to stop other boys from doing it.
Fez plopped down hard on the earth, like a merry bag of gelatin, blubbing for a moment until a type of inertial quiescence settled his fleebling quiver. He rubbed his feet in slow motion, trying to gather speed enough to vault the sand from the beach into his own face.
I'm not strong enough. I can't do it.
Fez shouted in frustration.
Here,
Ron said.
We'll pretend.
Ron picked up a handful of sand, and as Fezzy moved his legs as an old lady might, trying to scout out a lost slipper beneath her bed, Ron threw the sand into Fezzy's face. Even as the thrown sand was striking his uvula, Fez blurted out,
Now tell me I've stopped the other boys from doing that.
Ron rubbed his hands, lit a previously half-smoked cigarette from his schoolboy pack, and said,
I just did, kid.
But how?
Fez said.
I don't get it.
Ron shrugged.
All you gotta do is not be there kicking it in the first place.
But I'm not helping them,
Fez complained.
Impasse,
Ron said.
What?
Fez said.
You and me, Arata,
Ron said.
By the way, I can see his ass sticking out your diaper.
It's not a diaper. It's my swimming trunks all the way from New York.
Nevertheless, you should clean that rig up, or somebody'll take a hose to you. And let me tell you this, not from experience. You don't want no hose down in the driveway for a sand all ass.
Fez never did understand the lesson of that day, but he made a pact with himself to always pretend that he understood lessons, especially when he didn't. He also knew that the only way he could get away with such a life of pretending to understand lessons was by sticking with someone who did understand, someone who understood things without ever having to learn them. Unnatural, which is what Fez said to the air, to the universe, in a moment of perfect and absolute clarity.
Why, you're a natural.
And as young Fez Marie wondered how he could possibly manage to stay with the natural spoke to him.
Come on, buddy, let's start putting this band together. For Ronnie B. knew, as the street is to the car, as fire to the forest, so too does the natural need the unnatural.
For just as there are mysteries abounding in the world to explain, there needs to be someone there to explain them to. Someone to listen. Someone to work off of. Someone to misunderstand.
Hail St. Christopher, to the smoke and the awe. Oh, buckle down the rumble seat, let the radiator fall. Got it overhead down, shift, hit a two-down.
All right, that's the end of part one. Part two coming up in a few moments.
Books on tape. Turn the page.
What did you think, Fez?
I enjoyed it. I didn't care how I was depicted so much, but overall I enjoyed the production qualities of it.
You didn't like that me and you came off like a couple of cartoon mice that didn't bother you even slightly? Yeah, kid.
I felt like I came off as Gollum from Lord of the Rings.
But how? That's in real life. I thought you were portrayed a little better here. Chuck, you're on Fez.
Yeah, Ronnie, what's going on?
What do you say, buddy?
Yeah, I'm going to listen to that later tonight to put me to sleep.
There was something a little hypnotic about it. There's no doubt about
it's that. It's that Scottish whatever.
Scottish?
Well, what was that accent? The narrator?
I have no idea what it was. But I can tell you it wasn't Scottish. Patrick, you're on Run and Fez.
Hey, great bit, guys. Loving the show. I got nothing on the bit, but you got to remind Dave of the 70s Dr. Seuss story. Too many Daves.
Too many Daves. That is true. That was the story.
Okay.
About too many kids.
I never got
Dave.
That book.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. It costs money. Oh.
So that was Sleeves, his bit called The Natural. You can hear that on his website, adamsmotion.com.
Fred, you're on Run and Fez.
Hey, that was very interesting. It's a lot like Harry Potter book on tape. Kind of the same voice going on there. But I wanted to ask Fez... how did things work out with Baby Love? Did he make any decisions based on that? I didn't get to hear how you guys concluded.
Our bits never come to the end. That's what you have to remember. We build things up. Baby Love, The Summer of Earl, Dave's Tattoo. The Ron and Fez Show has no closure.
Tomorrow, the tattoo artist will be in effect.
What time?
1 o'clock.
Is the victor coming in to watch you get this tattoo?
I believe so, right? Yeah.
Julie, yep. Who won the sports trivia competition against Eastside Day before vacation.
Don, you're on Run of Fez.
Hey, buddies, how are you?
Good.
Fezzy, I just want to say, I don't really think you were painted in too well of a light there with that story, especially with trumpet thighs and an old woman trying to scout a slipper underneath the bed.
Yeah, it was very,
I wasn't the most capable in that rendition.
Well, that was you as a little kid. Not now. Now you're on top of things. You're like James Bond. Andrew, you're on Run and Fez.
As a literary critic, I have to say the characterization is perfect. However, too long, not enough of a focus, and I didn't really feel a sense of dread or doom or threat from the bullies. You know, there should have been some sound effects.
He's just a storyteller. He's not a guy who does sound effects. I got news for you. If I could do that voice, I'd be doing it constantly.
He was doing all the voices in that thing.
All? Let's not, you know, give him too much credit. It's one voice over and over.
And I believe I was British.
Phil, you're on Run and Fez.
Hey, what's up, boys?
Yeah.
Do me a favor, can you call Han's story? Just drove into a ditch.
To me, I think there's something there. I really do. Sleeves could be the future voice of the Ron and Fez Show.
The voice is good, but the length has got to be shaved down. Let's get it to 2 minutes.
We're not talking about a cock. We're talking about comedy.
Okay.
Yeah, but his comedy, it's not like set-up punchline stuff. It's more about setting the mood. And you had to admit, you started to glaze over and fall into that world.
Yeah, but if people are driving listening to our show, they will be dead.
It's like Shakespeare. You don't have to get it all to get it. You know what I mean? You don't have to understand it to get it. Here's John, you're on Run and Fez.
Yo, what's up, guys? I thought that was really good, and it sounded like an Orson Welles reading. I think that really flowed well.
There's something very, very strange about it. Dan, you're on Run and Fez.
Hey, wait till Dave gets his tattoo tomorrow, and then, like, right after the guy puts the needle away, fire his ass.
That would be great. As soon as you get whackbag.com tattooed on you. And then you just have to go around to O&A gigs with a tin cup, hoping people would love you.
Rob from Cliff's Tattoos in Center Reach, Long Island, New York, will be in tomorrow to do the whackbag.com tattoo.
Now, Fez, he's getting something on the bicep. Should he get something on the other side so there's... you know, some kind of balance in his life?
Yeah.
I mean, on the other bicep.
Oh, right. Yeah, I don't have anything on the left one.
You know what I'd like you to get? Sleeves. Just get sleeves.
That way you'll also know where your sleeves go when you're putting on a shirt.
True.
I can get RF forever.
Just get F forever. Or NF. here's Matt. Matt, you're on the Fez.
Yeah, I want to know if Earl listened to that before the show, and that's why he passed out.
Wow, man. People can be so brutal. You see that, Dave? It's not just you. It's anything that's not me and Fez. They attack.
Well, that makes me feel a little bit better then, I guess. You know?
You shouldn't.
No?
Well,
no.
You're no sleeves.
I mean, I don't try and put on a Scotch accent, at least, so I have one up on sleeves there. You know?
What about you going for a joke one day?
That was an attempt.
Seriously.
That's the sad part about it.
That's a missed layup.
Yeah.
And in terms of basketball and comedy, come on, bro. It's right there for you.
Okay.
Steve, you're on Ron and Fez.
I was wondering if maybe tomorrow, too, and she could get I Love Chef's Cup tattooed on her arm.
No, we're not going to do that. Let's not do that.
She won't be getting any tattoos.
Is the girlfriend still crying about you getting a tattoo tomorrow?
She doesn't know that I'll have a tattoo tomorrow.
We'll tell her this. We'll be right back, Ron and Fez.